Okay, hello everybody. Today I am going to be lecturing instead of Honor. He's out of town. My name is Lavanya, and I think most of you here know me. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Lavanya. I'm a PhD student working with Honor. I'm in my fourth year. And I work on main memory management and main memory interference mitigation, which is why I'm going to be talking about that today. So today's lecture is going to be about some of my own work and a little bit of work that Honor has done with another collaborator. So first of all, I mean, I am audible, right? This is not a big class, but at the back, okay, cool. So this is probably familiar to you guys by now, because Honor has been flashing this outline for a few lectures now, I think. And he's been mainly covering the quality of service memory controllers part, where I think he's covered a lot of these approaches in extensive detail. And he's also, I think there's also been lectures on interconnects and cache management, right, earlier?
Yes.
Earlier, okay. So I guess this is something, the smart resources part, where each shared resource is equipped with the intelligence or smartness to make its own resource management decisions. That part has been covered. And today what I'm going to be doing is talking about the second part, second half of this slide, which is dumb resources, where you keep each resource free for all in the sense that you don't equip each resource with its own smartness or intelligence, but you manage, I mean, you map data to it, or you control interference at a different level. And that will become apparent as I just talk about these two approaches. So first I'll talk about quality of service aware data mapping to memory controllers. So this memory channel partitioning, so this is work that I was doing about a year back in collaboration with others, from Sai Prashant from Penn State, owner here, Mahmood Kandamir, Professor Mahmood Kandamir from Penn State, and Thomas from Microsoft Research. So a bunch of us. Now, the outline of this talk is going to be this way. So as you're all primed to think about by now, memory inter-application interference is bad at the memory. And there's been major previous work in this direction, which is application-aware memory request scheduling, right? So this is something you've seen in all the past lectures. There's Atlas, TCM, STFM, and whatnot. So today, I'm going to be talking about a different approach, application-aware memory channel partitioning. And next, I'll talk about integrating these two approaches. So to connect this back to the previous slide, the one on the left is really a smart resources approach, because the memory controller is equipped with the intelligence to make smart memory management decisions. And on the right, it's really a dumb resources approach, where you map data appropriately, but the memory controller does not have any intelligence in terms of management. We look to see how we can combine these two approaches to achieve even better performance. Okay, so this just to give you some brief background about the memory, which you're all probably very familiar. Have I turned on rehearse timings? Yes. Sorry about that. Okay, that's good. So this is background you're all probably very familiar with now, memory organization. There are banks, there are rows, columns, and the row buffer. And accessing a data, a large chunk of data is brought into the row buffer, and subsequent accesses to that data in that same segment or same row are serviced in the row buffer itself. This is called a row buffer hit. And the previous memory scheduling policy called FRFCFS capitalizes on this and prioritizes row buffer hits and older requests. So this is familiar stuff, right? Just to get a sense of where you guys all are. Okay. Sure. So the problem with this is it's unfair. It's not aware of interference between applications, which is why previous work has looked at memory request scheduling. And the basic idea behind request scheduling, if you distill all the principles from all the previous classes, is you monitor applications' memory access characteristics, which is what Atlas does, which is what TCM does. And you rank applications based on these characteristics. And you use this ranking, you enforce this ranking to prioritize requests at the memory controller. Now, TCM, you've seen TCM. I'm going to skip this. So just an example for what TCM does. So the non-intensive cluster is prioritized over the intensive cluster. And you basically group threads into two clusters, and you apply priorities between the different clusters and between and within threads in the same cluster also, right? So now the advantage of doing this is it reduces interference, it's effective in doing that, and improves system performance. But the disadvantage is you require modifications at the memory controller, because it's done in memory scheduling. And the other disadvantage is reordering can only reduce interference to a certain degree. It cannot really eliminate interference. So on that, I'm not claiming to eliminate interference, but at least trying to go closer to that is the goal of this work. So our approach, application aware memory channel partitioning, like I said, is different from the previous approach. And this is built on the observation that modern systems have multiple memory channels. So earlier we typically had systems where there were a bunch of cores and they were sharing one memory channel. But now modern systems typically have a lot of more than one memory channel, which gives us a new degree of freedom. Data can now be mapped across these different channels in different ways, right? So I mean, of course, stop me at any point if there are questions or if anything is not clear. So data can now be mapped across different channels in different ways. But the question is, how is it done in current systems? Typically, all applications' data is mapped across all channels. So there are two applications here, and the data is mapped across all channels. So each chunk there is a page, I mean, or a, yeah. And mapping all data on all channels causes the interference between applications' requests, as you would expect. And ideally, it would be nice if you could map each application's data on its own channel, right? But that would eliminate interference between applications' requests. But the problem is you don't have as many, you know, channels as cores or applications, which is why we propose a memory channel partitioning mechanism where the goal is to eliminate harmful interference between applications. And how do we define harmful? The basic idea, I mean, we'll talk about that in just a bit. But the basic idea is to map the data of applications that interfere badly with each other to different memory channels. And the key principles to do this are to separate out harmful applications' data. And as you've seen in previous lectures, low and high memory intensity applications interfere with each other, right? So they're harmful. High memory intensity applications are harmful to the low. That's one key principle. So map the data on different channels. Similarly, low and high overflow locality applications also interfere with each other. Map the data on different channels. I'll walk over each of these two in the next couple of slides. So let's see how this works. So there are two cores here, and each of them runs an application, the red application, blue application, and there are two channels here, channel 0 and channel 1. Each channel has two banks, bank 0, 1, and this is basically time, and this is conventional page mapping in the sense that both applications' data, red and blue applications' data, is mapped on all channels, okay? And let's see how requests come in to these different channels and banks. So because both application data are mapped on all channels and banks, the red application, which has high memory intensity, just ends up sending requests to all banks and channels. It has high memory intensity, and that's just its nature. But the blue application has low memory intensity, and it has just one request, and it's just to that one bank, bank 0 of channel 0, if you see. So what happens is the blue application single, so this one more request from the red application, but the blue application single request ends up waiting for a long amount of time to get serviced. But if you map the red application's data to one channel and the blue application's data to another channel, that's ideal in the sense that it's ideal because it would eliminate interference between these applications requests. So that way the blue application does not stall for a long time. It spends much less amount of time waiting for memory. And the red application also incidentally benefits in this case. Of course, you can think of counterexamples where this would not work, but this is clearly a case where there is benefit to mapping the data of low and high memory intensity applications to different channels. And that's really our first key insight. Second insight is separated by row buffer locality. So I'll walk over this relatively faster because I covered a similar example on the previous slide. But here are the two applications, and they have different row buffer locality characteristics. If you see, the red application has two requests, and both of them are to row 0, R0. So this R0 inside indicates the row to which that request is going. And both of them go to R0 of bank 1. Now the blue application has more requests, and all of them tend to be to different rows in different banks. So clearly the blue application's request, all of this is assuming you employ a simple FRF CFS policy that tries to prioritize row hits and older requests. So if you employed an FRF CFS policy, the row hits are to R0 are going to be prioritized and they'll get serviced fast. But the row misses from the blue application, they are going to wait, right? And the blue application ends up waiting for a long time. Now again, if you map the data of the red application to one channel and the blue to another channel, the blue application starves for less amount of time, right? It stalls for less amount of time. And the red application also spends pretty much a similar amount of time waiting for memory. So that clear? I mean, those are the really two key takeaway slides. If this is clear, then the rest of at least this mechanism is going to be relatively clear. So that's the second insight, which is mapping the data of low and high row buffer locality applications to different channels is beneficial to reduce interference. So now the one question that's probably on your mind is, all of this is fine, perfect, if you had two channels and two applications. Now what if I have more number of applications and few number of channels, which is very typical in systems. So which is why we need a channel partitioning mechanism where we have different steps. First step is to profile applications. So like I said earlier, if you remember, these two slides demonstrate which applications interfere badly with each other, right? So now the goal is to map the data of these badly interfering applications to different channels. So you want low intensity applications, you can put them together because they're all going to be low intensity. You want high intensity applications, you can put them together because they're all going to be high intensity. But then you don't want to put them on the same channels because this hurts the low intensity pretty badly. So that's where our channel partitioning mechanism comes in. So five major steps: profile applications, get their access characteristics like intensity and row buffer locality. So once you have these access characteristics, classify applications into different groups based on intensity and row buffer locality, and partition channels between these application groups. And finally, you assign a preferred channel to each application and allocate application pages to that preferred channel. So if you see, we started with all applications, we grouped them, and we assigned them different groups of channels. So in some sense, we are trying to separate data of badly interfering applications to different sets of channels. And the interesting thing here is, if you remember, one way I motivated this was to say that this incurs low hardware complexity, which is because only the profiling part needs to be done in hardware. Beyond that, the way we envision this mechanism is pass on all the profile information up to the operating system. So from there on, the operating system or system software more generally takes over and uses this profile information to classify applications into groups and use this classification to partition channels and eventually assign data and put data on the different channels. So, any questions so far? No. Okay. So, there are these different steps. So, I guess maybe I'll not walk over these. Do you want me to walk over each of these different steps and tell you what exactly happens there, or you get the high level idea and you want me to go ahead? Okay, I'm going to go ahead in the interest of covering more stuff. So, yeah. So, that's how you classify, you look at, that's a bird's eye view of how different things are. And then you allocate groups of applications onto different channels. The allocation policy is different for different kinds of groups, and those are all really the implementation details of the, or not really implementation, but those are really the concrete details of the mechanism, which I'm skipping over now. So this last part is something I'd like to cover: allocate page to preferred channel. So far, the goal has been to classify applications into groups and assign each application a preferred channel, right? So the last part is, how do you enforce this allocation? By using on a page fault, the operating system tries to see if it can allocate the page to the preferred channel, preferentially, if there is a free page available. There isn't a free page available, we use a replacement policy that tries to preferentially find a page in the preferred channel. If it's not available, then it just allocates the page to another channel. So the key takeaway here is, this is not a hard partitioning mechanism where you partition main memory space into different partitions and strictly allocate only certain data on certain partitions, right? So that would be bad in the sense, if you ran out of space on your partition, what do? You start page faulting and thrashing, which is something you don't want happening. So that is what mechanism. That's why I'd like to highlight this part alone. So now, to put everything together, we have operates on an interval basis, and the first step, if you break up entire time into intervals, during an interval, applications are profiled. And at the end of an interval, this information is passed on to the operating system, which in turn classifies applications into groups and partitions channels between these groups and allocates a preferred channel to applications. Okay? And the next interval, these channel preferences are really enforced, which is where I was talking about the operating system trying and allocating pages on the preferred channel. So far, this is the memory channel partitioning mechanism itself. If you remember, at the beginning of the class, I was talking about memory request scheduling being the prior approach, channel partitioning being the approach that we propose. But then both of these approaches can be integrated in a smart way without incurring much hardware complexity, because if you remember, that's key to our mechanisms, right? We really want to keep the hardware cost low. So we have to be careful that we don't incur much hardware complexity. And I'll talk about our scheme, integrated memory partitioning and scheduling, that just does that. So we built the scheme based on the following observations. First, applications with low memory intensity, very low memory intensity, they hardly access memory. And dedicating channels to them really results in wasted bandwidth. If you think about it, say you have a bunch of very low intensity applications, you put them all on their own channel, just one channel, right? If they don't have enough requests, then they're going to underutilize the bandwidth, and you're wasting that bandwidth. You could have in turn used it in a better way for the high intensity applications, because they are almost always craving for more bandwidth. But they have the most potential to keep their cores busy. So you want to, in some way, prioritize them. You want to give them preferential treatment in some way helping the request to get serviced faster. So the solution we propose is, because they interfere, and the, okay, before I get to the solution, another point is they also interfere minimally with other applications. So prioritizing them is not really going to hurt other applications. So, I mean, as you probably guessed by now, where I'm heading is to always prioritize the very low memory intensity applications in the scheduler and use channel partitioning to mitigate interference between other applications. So one question you might ask is, how is this simpler? This is simpler because to prioritize low intensity applications, all we do is have one bit. An application is either a low intensity application or not. So that's how we prioritize it. And that has much lower complexity than a TCM-like or Atlas-like scheme that takes a large number of bits, has a full-blown ranking, and ranks between each application's request. So, I mean, just what I was talking about now, the hardware cost for MCP is only profiling counters and hardware. Everything else happens in the system software. No modifications to the memory scheduling logic. So it's pretty low, 1.5 kilobytes of storage cost for a 24-core 4-channel system. And integrated memory partitioning and scheduling, there is a single bit required per request, and the scheduler needs some simple comparison logic to schedule based on this just this one bit. Okay. So here is our methodology. Before I present some results quickly, we do our simulations on a 24-core 4-channel system, and there are 4 banks on each channel. That's just the system we simulate on, and we simulate across a wide range of workloads with different memory intensity categories. And we evaluate weighted speed up because the goal of this work is really system performance. So these are the previous works we compare to. I am not going to describe them in detail because I believe you guys have been exposed to this in the past few lectures. So it's FRFCFS, there's Atlas, which prioritizes based on attained service, if you remember, right? I mean, were these all readings or they were, and you guys read them?
Some were readings.
Okay. Atlas was a reading?
No.
Oh, okay, sure. So, yeah, I'm assuming you guys remember. If you don't, you'll have to stop me and ask me what I'm talking about. So, Atlas just prioritizes applications with low intensity, and TCM does a little bit more than that. It clusters applications, prioritizes some of them because they have low intensity, but then shuffles priorities for other applications because enabling them to make fair progress, right? That's what TCM does. Now, here we compare MCP and IMS, the last two bars, to these three mechanisms, right? So first conclusion is, MCP and IMS improve performance significantly over the baseline FRFCFS scheme, okay, while incurring pretty low complexity. And next, if we compare to the best previous scheme, TCM, MCP performs pretty similarly to TCM, but the thing to remember is it has much lower hardware cost. That's really the takeaway point. So similar performance to TCM with lower hardware cost. And IMS, in fact, improves performance over TCM by about 5%, but it also has low hardware. I mean, MCP has... No, it requires no changes to the memory controller. IMS requires minimal modifications to the memory controller, which is still low compared to something like TCM. Yeah. So next, that's part of the evaluation. So next, I'll present interaction with memory scheduling. So if we think about it, channel partitioning is really one way of doing things, and memory scheduling is another way of doing things. And if we think about how we can integrate them and how they interact with each other, these results, again, the y-axis here is normalized system performance, and these are 3 algorithms, FRFCFS, Atlas, and TCM. And here is their system performance, normalized FRFCFS, when they're just employed, right? There is no channel partitioning or IMS employed on top of it. Now, when I apply IMS on top of these 3 scheduling policies, it turns out that there are benefits over all scheduling policies, which means an IMS-like approach definitely provides benefit over all policies. But the highest benefits are over FRFCFS. And if you think about it, the reason is this, right? The way we built up MCP, which is a large component of IMS, was we started with FRFCFS, and we looked at what are the sources of unfairness in FRFCFS, namely low and high intensity applications interference, and low and high overflow locality application interference. So we looked at these specific sources, and we mitigated interference from those 2 sources. So this mechanism is really designed for FRFCFS. So, I mean, there could be better channel partitioning policies that can be designed with Atlas as the baseline or with TCM as the baseline, and I think some tweaks on top of that could do better, because if you think about it, these policies could go against each other, right? I mean, if you don't coordinate them well, they could go against each other, and they might be doing the same thing, or they might be doing, you know, contradictory things which are counterproductive. So that's something to explore, and I mean, that's a potential research direction that, I mean, anyone can take up if they're interested. Look at these different scheduling policies and see how they interact with channel partitioning. So in summary, uncontrolled inter-application interference is bad. And application-aware memory channel partitioning, mitigates this interference in a simple way by separating the data of badly interfering applications to different channels. Next, we integrate channel partitioning with memory scheduling, and we prioritize low-intensity applications to the scheduler while handling interference between other applications using channel partitioning. And we provide good performance improvements while incurring much lower hardware cost. So that summarizes my discussion of the first part of the lecture, which is MCP and channel partitioning and IMS. So any questions on that? I think I'm talking to you guys at a bad time of the day when you're all done for the day and you're waiting to go home, so or waiting to go back and do other things. So, okay, so I'm going to move on to the next part of this lecture. So once again, our familiar outline slide, we're still on dumb resources. And we looked at this first bullet here, quality of service aware data mapping to memory controllers, right? Now next I'll talk about another approach, source throttling, which is also in some sense a dumb resource approach. And the work is fairness via source throttling, which Onur did in collaboration with the folks at UT Austin. So to set you up for what this work does, here is a nice motivational picture. There are these different cores running different applications, and they all share a large part of the memory hierarchy in the memory system, right? There are shared caches, there's the memory controller, there's the interconnect, there are DRAM banks. I mean, they're all shared resources. And there's interference in each of these resources. And the previous approaches we've studied, especially, I mean, you've looked at interconnect, caches, memory, they've all tried to independently mitigate interference at these resources, right? So if you look at channel partitioning and memory scheduling, the focus has been on memory control and the memory alone and trying to mitigate interference there. If you look at the cache work, maybe did you guys cover utility-based cache partitioning or not in this course? Okay. Sure. So if you look at the way interference is mitigated in caches, we try and do smart things to prevent different applications from taking up, you know, all of the cache share and you're doing fair sharing between them and things like that. Interconnect similar policies, which I guess Chris talked about at some point. But the bottom line is these mechanisms are all uncoordinated. They're all designed for that specific resource. And if you don't coordinate them explicitly, it could result in bad performance because they might just end up being counterproductive, right? So that is really the question is, how do we enable fair sharing of the entire memory system, memory hierarchy, by controlling interference between them in a coordinated manner, which is what FSD does, and using an approach called source throttling. So the basic idea is, do not manage interference at the shared resource itself, but manage interference at the cores. And how do we do that? Is to dynamically estimate the amount of unfairness in the memory system, figure out which applications are interfering, figure out which applications are interfered with, and use this information and feed this back into a controller. And the controller then uses that information in a centralized manner. So everything goes into a centralized place, and that controller uses the information to throttle back different cores. So the decisions on whom to throttle, when to throttle, how much to throttle by, that depends on what you're optimizing for. Is the goal performance, or you know, is that one thread specifically important? They depend on what really is your goal. But this is really the high-level idea. For example, if the system software could possibly tell the controller, memory controller, that this is how much I want my system's unfairness to be. So it can use that information to potentially favor some applications. And you know, it's a feedback loop kind of mechanism where you get slowdown estimates from hardware, use those slowdown estimates and unfairness estimates to potentially throttle back some applications and not throttle back, I mean, and throttle up certain other applications. So the throttling down, throttling up part, we'll talk about it and I'll describe how we do that in more detail. So here is an example to motivate the benefits or the need for how source throttling would work. So top here, we're looking at the case where there's unmanaged interference. There are two applications, A and B, and they're sharing memory resources, and they're generating a bunch of requests. Both of them first do some amount of compute, and then they generate a bunch of requests. This is the order in which the requests are generated, and they're queued up here. So if you see all of A's requests, application A's requests come first because they came first, I mean they queued up first, and B's requests came later. So if you employed some kind of a policy where, let's say, we just service requests in the order in which they were queued up, all of A's requests would get service first, and A would stall on these requests. And only then, so A stalls for this amount of time. But core B, if you see, it's been waiting not because its requests were serviced, but because Core's requests were being serviced, right? So it's been stalling because of interference. If it had been running alone, it would not have been stalling. And finally, its request gets serviced at this point. So overall, it stalls for a really long time. And the reason is, this intensive application A generates a large number of requests that stall this unintensive application B. Now, what do we do about this? How do we use throttling to mitigate this problem? So same request generation order, both of them doing compute, and they generate a bunch of these requests. Now, instead of servicing these requests in this order in which they were queued, can we move them around? If we move B single request B1 further and move A2, A3, and A4 further back, by throttling them, by effectively throttling the rate at which core A injects requests, that would enable B to make faster progress. So if you see, this is the order in which requests are now serviced. B's request has come up ahead because A's request is throttled back and sent back. Now first, A1 is serviced because that's the order in which it's queued. But now instead of A2, A3 and A4, B1 is serviced. So B is done waiting, B is done stalling, and it can go back and resume computation. So that's about core B stall time. So now core A stalls for more time. A2, A3 and A4 need to be serviced. So overall, there are extra cycles for which core A stalls. But if you think about it, as compared to that plot to here, this is much smaller compared to this large amount of time that core B was stalling in the first place. So that's really the benefit. You're really benefiting core B. You're saving a large number of cycles for core B by increasing the amount of time core A waits by a little bit. And if you remember, this is partially the intuition that Atlas or TCM also used, right? Why do we prioritize non-memory intensive applications? Because you can enable them to make a lot of progress by just servicing those one or few of their requests. So in that sense, it's a similar intuition, but then you use that intuition very differently to throttle back requests instead of managing it at the memory. So now this is really a motivational figure, and having motivated the benefits and perhaps the need for source throttling, let me talk about FST itself, the mechanism, and its major components. So two major components. First is the runtime unfairness evaluation in hardware. I mean, it's done in hardware at the memory controller. So estimate how much is the unfairness in the system and figure out which applications are slowing down terribly, and figure out which applications are slowing others down terribly by causing interference. So once this information is available, feed this back into the controller, like I said, and use this information to dynamically throttle back requests. So when I say throttle back, what you really control is how aggressively each core makes requests to the shared resources. And this is done by really at a high level, limiting the, if you remember, there are MSHRs, right? Each core has its MSHRs. If you limit the number of MSHRs that a core can use, that limits the number of in-flight requests. Similarly, if you limit the rate at which a request from the MSHRs can be injected into the system, that also throttles back the cores, right? So that's really the high-level idea. So now to present a more pictorial example of how FST would operate, during an interval, let's say interval 1, slowdowns are estimated. And once you have these slowdowns, these can be used to estimate system unfairness. And I'll talk about what that is concretely in just the next slide. But for now, bear with me and assume that you have slowdowns, you can figure out, you have some notion of the unfairness in the system. So once that is available, you can also use the slowdown information to find out which application is slowing down the most and which application is slowing down others the most, meaning which application is causing most interference to the app for the app slowest. So pass on this information from the runtime unfairness evaluation to the dynamic request throttling mechanism. So now once this information is available, what you really want to see is the unfairness estimate greater than or lower than a given target. If it's greater than a target, you're being more unfair than you can be. So throttle back the interfering application and throttle up the interfered application, the slowest application. That's really the basic idea. We'll walk over each of these steps. So first, let's look at this part, estimating system unfairness. So like I said, this is really a concrete definition of unfairness that FST uses, which is maximum slowdown of any application divided by the minimum slowdown of any application, where slowdown of each application itself is defined as the ratio of the time it runs when it's sharing the system with other applications over when it's run alone. Right. Now the question is, this TI shared factor, this can be, if you think about it, it can be estimated in a straightforward way, right? I mean, how would you do it? I'm on board of that.
So that's up. So how did you get TI shared? Is that easy or straightforward? So that's really the amount of time the application runs when sharing resources with others. Yes. You seem to have something to say.
No, I think that's it.
Okay, sure. So you basically use performance counters, just figure that out.
So the key question is, how do you figure out TI alone? Which cannot, without really running that application alone, right? If I had the luxury of running the application alone and figuring out its time taken, that would be cool, but I can't do that. So given that, how do I work around that? And the way I work around that is really by expressing alone as a function of these two things, right? This can be shared and the access cycles that the application stalls because it was interfered with. So what you really want to do is figure out these access cycles and use that to compute TI alone, because this can be figured out in a straightforward manner. And that's what I'll talk about in the next few slides. How do you figure out that access? Tracking inter-core interference, that's how we figure out the access cycles. So there are really three major sources of interference that FST focuses on. First is the shared caches, then the DRAM bank and bus, and then the DRAM row buffers. So let's just zoom in on the row buffers for now and look at how FST, using its hardware support, estimates the interference that is experienced in the row buffers. I'm not going to be talking in detail about shared caches and the DRAM banks and buses, but that detail can be found in the paper and you can read that up. So at the row buffer interference, tracking DRAM row buffer interference, there are two cores here and each of them is running an application, right? So core 0 is accessing row A, same color code, and core 1 is accessing row B, same bank, we're just looking at bank 2. And row A is already open in bank 2. So now let's look at what hardware support FST keeps to monitor inter-core interference. So first is an interference per core bit vector. So there's one bit for each core to keep track of how much is that core interfered with or not. And for the row buffer specifically, there's something called the shadow row address register. So this is really for each core, it's on a per core basis. And for each core, it keeps track of the last accessed row from that core. Okay, it's similar to shadow row buffers if you guys have seen that at some point. But it really keeps track of the last accessed row from that core. Now, let's look at how these requests are serviced. So this access from row A, it goes, hits in the row buffer because that row is already open. And it goes into the shadow row address register because that was the last access row from core 0. Next access from row B, it's a row conflict, and it goes into the shadow row address register. Okay. Second access from row B hits, that's fine. Now this access from row A conflicts. But if you go and look up the contents of the shadow row address register for core 0, it has row A. So if core 0 had been running alone without sharing with core B, then row A would not, this access to row A would have been a row hit. It would not have been a row conflict, which is what we figure out from looking up this shadow row address register. So it's really, this row conflict is induced because of interference. It would not have happened if there were no interference. So set the bit corresponding to core 0 to indicate that it was interfered with. Okay, first step towards estimating the access. Now, once this bit is set, let's see how we use that to estimate TXs. So this is, again, really what we're interested in. So now I'm going to assume that there are mechanisms at the shared caches, memory controller, and at the DRAM row buffers to track interference. And I'm just going to talk about how is TXs controlled once you know that an application has been interfered with, once this bit is set, right? So this bit is set when, let's say that's the memory controller, and core 0 is interfered with at the memory controller. So this bit is set. And that mechanism I did not describe. Go and read that up. So once this bit is set, you know that core 0 is being interfered with at the memory controller. So during that time is when it's experiencing interference and you really want to increment TXs during that period. So any cycle during which that bit is set, you increment TXs. So next what happens is core 2 is interfered at the shared cache and this bit is set for core 2 as well. So now TXs has to be incremented for both core 0 and 2, because both cores are being interfered with in these cycles. And then eventually when these requests are done being serviced at the shared cache and the memory controller, and I say request, the interfering request is done, then core 0 or core 2 is not experiencing any interference anymore, right? So at that point, these bits really have to be reset. So at that point, TXs count will stop. At a high level, set these bits when the application is experiencing interference and count TXs whenever these bits are set, and reset this bit when the application stops experiencing interference. That's the high level idea. Now, the next part is that was in some sense talking about the interference estimation mechanism. Next is, how do you find out the application with the highest slowdown? I'm not going to too much details here, but you really need some kind of a matrix here, right? You need to figure out which application is interfering with which other application. And you also need some information to track at a pairwise level the PXs. So you want to find out how much interference is an application, say core 0 or application 0, causing to application 1 or 2. So I mean, so in this case, for example, core 2 is interfering with core 1. So you want to increase that count by 1. And then you can use this information to find out a lot of things. You can find out which application is the most slowed down. You can find out which application is causing the most interference and so on. So the bottom line is, when once you have this matrix, you can use this information to figure out a lot of things. So that's how we figure out these two aspects, which is the highest slowed down application and the most interference causing application on the highest slowed down application. So once this information is available, pass this down to the dynamic request throttling mechanism and throttle down the most interfering application and throttle up the most slowed down application. So how do we do that? At a high level, like I said earlier, the goal is really to adjust the rate at which, how aggressively each core makes requests to the shared memory system. And we do that with two different aspects. One is the MSHRs, miss status holding registers. Give a quota to each application. An application can use only so many entries, which restricts the number of requests of that application that can be in flight. Next is, even from those limited entries, you can inject only so frequently. That also controls the rate at which the application sends out requests to the shared memory system. More concretely, a throttling level is assigned to each core to determine its MSHR quota and the injection rate. So these are the different throttling levels. There are a total of 128 MSHRs in the system. And when the throttling level is 100%, it means there's no throttling. All MSHR entries can be used and a request can be injected every cycle. But then progressively, as the throttling level decreases, let's take one example, 5%. The MSHR quota is only 6, and only once in every 20 cycles can a request be injected. So that's a different throttling level. So that's really the second aspect of the mechanism, which is the throttling part. Now, to put everything together and show FST at work, estimate slowdown during an interval. So that is this interval, interval I. Okay. And at this point in time, these are really the throttle levels of the different cores. So core 0 and core 2 are throttled, core 1 and core 3 are not throttled. Okay. So at the end of interval I, you get estimates from the unfairness estimate evaluation mechanism. So if you see, the unfairness estimate is 3, based on the definition we saw a few slides earlier, right? Max slowdown by minimum slowdown. That's really the unfairness estimate. So you have that number, and you also know which application is slowing down the most, core 2, and which application is interfering with it the most, core 0. So you have all of that information. So now you go and compare this 3 against the system software defined goal of 1.4. So lower is better, right? You're not meeting the unfairness target that the system sets for you. So now throttle up the core that's being unfairly treated, core 2, while throttling down the core 0, that's causing interference to core 2. So that means you need to, so interval I plus 1, things change, right? At this point, this has a different throttling level, this has a different throttling level, this has gone up, core 2 has gone up, core 0 has gone down to 25%. Now, once again, it's a feedback loop based mechanism. Look at unfairness estimates and look at what they say. So this is 2.5. Sorry, it should not be overlapping with the text there. But it's 2.5. You're coming closer to 1.4, but you're not there yet. And now another thing has changed. Core 2 is still the most unfairly treated, but it's being interfered with terribly by core 1 rather than by core 0, as we saw earlier. So now you need to throttle up core 2, but then throttle down core 1. So that's what this results in. So in the next interval, I plus 2, core 1 and 2 are both at same throttle level and so on. So it's I'm just showing two intervals, but then this goes on. And it's a feedback loop based mechanism where you try and meet the system software defined goal. Now, if you think about it, the slowdown information is really enabling you to do a lot of things. You could do other things as well, right? One is what we just looked at, estimating unfairness and checking it against the system software defined target unfairness to see if it's meeting it and doing things based on if it's meeting it or not. Next is to keep track of the maximum slowdown any application experiences, because if you remember, FST really gives you the slowdown information. So you can figure out which application being slowed down the most and do something smart to not slow it down. Or there might be one application alone that you care about, as I'll talk about in just a second, the next work. There might be one application that you care about and you might want to keep its performance in check. That's another possibility. And furthermore, support for thread priorities can also be interweaved into this mechanism. So let's say the system software defined a weight for this thread. Okay. You can factor that into the estimated slowdown. If the weight is high, then it means that the thread has to be given more priority, right? So when do you give a thread more priority in the vanilla FST mechanism when it has higher slowdown? So if you can artificially boost up its slowdown by multiplying the weight with the slowdown, that would give the thread more higher priority, and you can, you know, potentially prioritize the thread. So the hardware cost for FST is relatively low. It's about 12 kilobytes for 4 cores, and FST does not require, so one downside to FST also is for 4 cores it's okay, but then if you start scaling up you have an interference per core matrix, and that makes things costly and complex. So I'll talk about another mechanism soon that does not have that kind of complex thing, is also more accurate. Okay, and the other thing is FST does not require any structures or logic that are on the process critical path. That's true, but it still could be expensive when you scale up to a large number of cores. So FST evaluation, I'm not going into the details. It's a 4-core system, I guess, one channel. So these are different approaches. High level, no unfairness. I mean, no fairness, meaning the mechanism is not designed to provide any kind of fairness. First bar, blue bar. And okay, sorry, before I go there, the y-axis here is system unfairness, which is measured, as maximum slowdown. It's measured as maximum slowdown. And there are different approaches. Fair cache capacity is a mechanism that provides fairness at the caches alone. And next is parallelism-aware batch scheduling. You saw that in class, right? That is combined with the fair caching approach. So that's a so here is a classic example of two approaches that are designed to mitigate unfairness at different resources, but they're not really coordinated. So FST coordinates them, and it ends up achieving much lower unfairness, about 36% lower than the best previous approach at that point. So next, performance also benefits. So this is showing system performance, so normalized to the no unfairness case. So again, as can be seen, on average, there are system performance benefits to improving fairness as well, because if you make the overall system fairer, it also ends up improving system performance. There's a trade-off between performance and fairness, but in some cases, it definitely helps, and that's really the case here. So, I mean, I'm not going into specific workloads and stuff, right? So the key takeaways are source throttling alone provides better performance than, you know, putting together approaches that were designed for different resources separately. Because decisions made at these different resources can contradict each other and can cause unfairness. And neither source throttling nor smart resources alone provides the best fairness. If you think about it, different resources, different approaches work for different workloads and different systems and configurations and so on. So really, combined approaches where you try and apply these approaches, I mean, either make some of the resources smarter, but then also do some kind of centralized control by throttling. That's potentially a direction to go, and that's probably the way that would work best, right? So to summarize, the different approaches, smart versus dumb. The smart approaches were the memory scheduling techniques, and the dumb resources were the source throttling and channel partitioning techniques. Like I said, neither approach is the best. I mean, as with computer architecture, we're always full of trade-offs. Something works in some cases, it doesn't work in other cases, and always have a reason for why it works or doesn't work. So no single approach works best for all workloads, and we really want to try and put them together. So all approaches are effective, and they can be applied at different levels. I mean, I guess reiterating the same thing. And combined approaches really work well. So one example of a combined approach is really the integrated partitioning and scheduling approach, right? It just scratched the surface. It wasn't too detailed a study of combining. But then there was still scheduling, which is a smart resource approach, and channel partitioning, which is more a dumb resource approach, and you put them together, right? So possibly more research in that direction. Definitely, I think this is a good idea, trying to combine different techniques at different resources and coordinating them. So I think I'm going to skip this. Okay. So a large part of the QSO. Okay. Before I go on to the next segment, any questions on this? Nope. Okay. That's the. So to if I can pep you guys up by saying this is really the last segment of the lecture. So the QSO work so far. The major goals have been system performance and fairness, right? If you remember, we want to either optimize for overall system performance, or we want to be fair to all applications running on the system. But then, in today's clouds and today's clusters, there's really a need for some kind of a notion of predictable performance, right? And this need really comes from, you have multiple users, and you put all of their jobs, you consolidate them on the same server. So you want to provide some notion of predictable performance for the different users. And what you really need for that is, first of all, to be able to accurately predict performance. So what did FST do? FST was a step in that direction. And FST tried to say, let's figure out slowdowns of different applications, and let's use that slowdown, use the slowdown information to find out how unfair or fair the system is, and work based on that, right? That was really the approach that FST took, and is definitely a step in the right direction. But FST was not designed to provide predictable performance. It was still working to provide best effort policies where you optimize for fairness and so on, right? So that's why the slowdown estimates from FST are not very accurate, because it was not designed to be accurate. So here in this work, MICE is providing predictable performance in shared main memory systems. This is going to appear next year's HPCA. I will talk about how we can provide predictable performance in shared main memory systems. And to make things interesting, one of the co-authors on this paper is your classmate here. So if that makes things interesting. So shared resource interference is a problem. You've seen this enough. There are different shared resources in this interference. And this causes unpredictable application slowdowns, right? So I'm stealing Onur's slide. I know he likes flashing this slide. So there are different applications. There's MATLAB and GCC running on two different cores, and they slow each other down very differently. MATLAB suffers very low slowdown, whereas GCC suffers a high amount of slowdown. So far we've looked at it from the perspective of trying to see, let's be fair, let's try and equalize their slowdowns and so on. But the perspective that this work takes is to say, we really need predictable performance. We want to be able to predict. Slowdowns can be high or low, but the first step is we want to be able to predict them accurately to be able to do anything smart about them. And here are a couple of reasons why predictable performance is good. So let's take billing in a cloud, right? So you submit a job to a commodity cloud like Amazon's EC2. And they bill you by time. They bill you by how long you take to run. Now, if you're experiencing a lot of interference, you'll run longer and you end up paying more. So, I mean, it's ironic that you end up paying more when they're doing a bad job of managing the cloud, right? Which is why knowledge of slowdowns really enables smarter billing. Let's say at the end of the run, even for an application that you had no idea about going in, you know how much it slowed down by. That'll tell you how long it would have run had it not been experiencing interference, right? So that's clearly a motivation to be able to provide predictable performance. And another example is server consolidation. Multiple applications from different users consolidated on the server. And you want to provide some notion of bounded performance for each user and each application. So having given that motivation for predictable performance, we really want to work towards a predictable performance substrate. And we start with the main memory, because that's what we like in our group. So memory interference induced slowdown estimation, that's this work. And I'll quickly jump into our slowdown estimation model and talk about, so like I said earlier, the first step is to estimate slowdowns and use that information. So how do we estimate slowdowns? So FST has really tried to estimate slowdowns to give you just a sense. FST has tried to estimate slowdowns with both shared caches and memory, but then it's not very accurate, and B, it's complex. In this work, we try and address both of those concerns, but we start with just memory. We don't go into caches yet. That's the next step. So here is our first observation on which we build this work. For a memory-bound application, its performance is roughly proportional to its request service rate. So when I say request service rate, it's the rate at which its memory requests are serviced. So let me explain this. The results of this. These results are from a real system experiment where we ran each of these applications along with a memory hog on a Core i7 machine. So we could basically vary the intensity of the memory hog, or rather Ben ran them. So he varied the intensity of the memory hog and got the memory hog to pound the memory system badly, which means you can also vary the rate at which the legitimate application's requests are serviced, right? So this is normalized to one is really the point where the memory hog is not doing any memory. And this is the point where it's behaving pretty badly, right? So if you see, y-axis is performance, and there is a very strong correlation between request service rate and performance to the point that you can use service rate as a proxy for performance. And that's what we do. We express slowdown as the ratio of the alone request service rate to the shared request service rate. I mean, that's really this number, if you will. I mean, it's really the inverse of this number. So now again, a shared request service rate, like we saw earlier, T shared, that's easy to estimate because you just count it when an application is running along with others. The key question is, how do you figure out alone request service rate? And that's where our second observation comes in. So here is the application. We call it the red application, and it's running alone. And this is the request buffer, memory controller request buffer. It has two requests queued up in the request buffer. Now, because it's running alone, these two requests are just serviced back to back, and it's done. Now, let's complicate things a little bit more by adding another application, blue application, into the system. So there's one request from the red application, which is this request, and then the blue application's request, and only then the second red application's request. And if the memory scheduler service requests in the order in which they're queued up, this is what is going to happen. the red application's request is going to stall for more time than it was run along. However, let's say we had the same red application running with the blue application, but we just gave the red application highest priority at the memory controller. That way, both of the requests of the red application are serviced back to back, because it has highest priority and it just gets served. Whenever there is a request of the red application in the request buffer, it gets highest priority and it gets serviced. And only then does the blue application's request come in. So from the red application's perspective, this is the same as this. So it's almost as if it were unalo. So one thing I would like to prime you on here is I am making it sound ideal. It's not fully ideal. There are scenarios where this does not work perfectly, and I'll address that in just a bit. But for the most part, giving an application highest priority makes it experience very little interference. And so alone request service rate of an application can be measured by giving it highest priority in accessing memory. Okay? That's the second observation. So that way, if you remember, we had the slowdown equation. So you have both the numerator and denominator now. So one detail I've glossed over so far is I made it seem perfect. I made that model seem perfect, but that does not really work for all applications, because it works for memory bound applications because they're bottlenecked at memory and they spend a significant amount of time stalling for memory. But non-memory bound applications are a different deal. They spend more time doing compute and they spend less time doing memory. And the length of the compute phase is really unchanged by the rate at which memory requests are serviced, if you think about it, right? So that's why we tweak our slowdown estimation model to take this into account. So alpha, let me define some terminology first. Alpha here is the fraction of time an application spends in the memory phase. So, I mean, to be more concrete, there's a core, it does some amount of compute, and it sends out a memory request, and it starts stalling at some point, right? So alpha is really the fraction of time that it stalls. That's what we call the memory phase. So 1 minus alpha is the fraction of time that it's not stalled waiting for memory, meaning it's doing some amount of compute. And that part really does not change with the request service rate variation. So keep that the same and scale and change just this part, change the alpha fraction alone where it's doing memory to take into account this request service rate variation. Is that part clear? Make sense? Okay, cool. So that's really our final slowdown estimation model. So now the question is, based on these three observations, how do we actually implement our slowdown estimation model? We do it on an interval with an interval-based mechanism. You divide execution time into intervals and estimate slowdown at the end of each interval. In some sense, the interval-based mechanism is very similar to what FST does, but just that we do it differently with a different mechanism, which is more simpler and also more accurate, as you'll find out. Now, to estimate slowdown, these three components have to be measured at the end of each interval. There's the alone request service rate, shared request service rate, and the memory fraction alpha. Now, the shared request service rate and alpha, they can be measured in a straightforward manner. So I'll cover them first. That's the easy part, and we'll get out of the way first. The shared request service rate can be measured with a per core counter, where you track the number of requests serviced of each core. And at the end of each interval, measure the shared request service rate as the number of requests serviced over the length of the interval. And alpha, like I said, count the number of stall cycles, the core stalls waiting for memory, and compute the fraction of cycles it stalls, when you divide that by the interval length, that's the fraction of stall cycles. So both of these can be estimated in a straightforward manner. Now let's move on to the interesting part, which is the alone request service rate. If you remember, I said earlier that we need to give an application highest priority to measure its alone request service rate. And how do we do that? We break up each interval. If you remember, we're at the granularity of an interval now. We break up each interval itself into smaller epochs. At the beginning of an epoch, we randomly pick a highest priority application, and we give it highest priority. So the question is, how do we pick that application? The probability of picking an application is really proportional to its bandwidth allocation. That might seem a little cryptic at this point, but what we do is we build mechanisms on top of this model that allocates different amount of bandwidth to different applications. Say, let's say we had two applications, right? If I gave them 50-50, then half of the time, application A would have highest priority, and half of the time application would have highest priority. But for some reason, my mechanism sitting on top of my model decides that A needs more priority. It could say 75-25. Which means A is going to be given highest priority 75% of time, whereas B is going to be given highest priority 25% of time. But still, the end goal is at the end of each interval, each application would have definitely gotten highest priority, which means you can estimate its alone request service rate as a function of these two quantities. So what are these quantities? The numerator is the number of requests serviced when the application had highest priority, and the denominator is the number of cycles the application had highest priority. So it's really a request service rate, right? So these are really the cycles during which the application behaved like a highest priority application. So you count the number of requests that were serviced when the application was behaving like a highest priority application, and you divide that by the number of cycles it behaved like a highest priority application. So that's the basic idea. So now, finally, let's tackle the inaccuracy in the alone request service rate mechanism. So far, I've been making it sound very ideal, right? So when an application has highest priority, it experiences little interference from other applications, but it's not zero interference. And the reason is, here is an example showing that. So here's the red application, one request in the request buffer. It gets serviced. So just as it is being serviced, another application, another request from the blue application comes in. So now it's running along with the blue application, and we are trying to see how do we estimate alone request service rate. So the blue application's request comes in, and because this is done servicing, because this request is done servicing, the blue application's request is going to be scheduled. Why? Because you don't want to waste memory bandwidth. At this point in time, there is no request from the highest priority application, the red application, and you don't want to waste memory bandwidth, so let's just schedule whichever request is in the queue. So here goes the blue application. But unfortunately, just as it was being scheduled, this request came in. So now this request has no choice but to wait, right? I mean, you could think about preempting and doing things like, you know, canceling this request and letting this request go ahead. But if you remember the way DRAM operates, is you need to pre-charge, activate, and so on. So that's going to incur a lot of latencies that is anyway going to slow down things. So you might as well let that request go through, wait for that time, and then let the red application request go through. So these cycles are really interference cycles. The red application would not have experienced them had it been running by itself. And ideally, to estimate alone request service rate, you do not want to take into account these interference cycles. You really don't want this behavior. So how do we factor out this behavior? We factor out the interference cycles. That's really our solution. So if you see, and to draw a parallel to the way FST does this, FST also tries to factor out interference cycles. But the way this is a better mechanism is because we don't do it all the time. For the most part, give highest priority and take away a large part of the interference. But then, to factor out the interference cycles, this is the mechanism we follow. So, I mean, this is not a perfect mechanism, but if a request from the highest priority application is waiting in the buffer, but then another application the request was previously issued, then that is really an interference cycle, because this cycle would not have happened had the application been running by itself. So, what has changed here in this alone request service rate equation is this part, the interference cycles. So we add this into we subtract this from the denominator, because in reality, when an application was interfered with, it is not really a high priority epoch cycle, right? Which is why we take that out. So once we take that out, we have an estimate of alone request service rate. Now to put it all together, where did we start? We said let's divide execution time into intervals and measure and estimate the three major components. We walked over all of these components. We know how to estimate all of them now. So finally, once all of this is available, put them all together, plug them into the slowdown equation and get the slowdown. So one thing I'd like to point out here is there are a few inaccuracies we see in this model in terms, so we tweak it around to, I mean, we do a few little tweaks with the model. It's not as ideal as it looks, but I'm abstracting that detail away so as to just be able to provide the key idea. But we're working on trying to make it actually this. It's not fully this now at this point. So in terms of hardware cost, the total storage required for about 4 cores is around 96 bytes. Because if you see, you really need to keep track of the shared request service rate, alone request service rate, alpha. I mean, it's a few counters. It's not a large number of counters. So it has low storage cost. And to compare to FST had to keep track of this interference matrix and all that. So we don't really need to keep track of things like that. And next is the changes the memory scheduler are simple. So let me compare it to prior work. So major previous work has been on slowdown estimation has been stall time fair memory scheduling. Was that covered briefly or in detail? Okay, sure. So stall time fair memory scheduling and FST. Right. So one thing I didn't tell you earlier was FST really builds on STFM in terms of its memory interference detection mechanism. So how is the interference at the banks and buses detected very similar to STFM, stall time fair? In fact, they cite the paper and say it's a very similar mechanism to stall time fair. So for our purposes, for memory interference, STFM and FST are pretty much the same. So we treat them similarly because we don't take into account shared cache interference, which is where FST differs. Now, what is the basic idea? I'm not going to give you the basic idea here. It's to estimate the ratio of, interfered, I mean, you guys know FST. I'm not going to walk over that. So the two major advantages of MICE over STFM and FST, in fact, are, first is STFM, okay, substitute STFM with FST for memory, okay. Of course, the advantage that FST has is the take into account shared cache interference. But for memory, these are advantages. It really tries to estimate uninterfered stall time in the presence of a lot of interference, right? So that tends to become complicated. You need to factor out all interference very accurately. MICE addresses a large part of that problem by giving an application highest priority. And only the remaining interference we factor out based on this interference count mechanism. So next advantage is STFM slowdown, STFM and FST slowdown estimates are inaccurate for low intensity applications. And the reason is, there is no accounting for compute phase in FST, if you will, right? So just look at how long does it wait? How long does it wait for memory? How long does it not wait for memory? I mean, that's really some notion of the execution times that FST takes into account. Whereas we more explicitly say that the compute phase does not change, and we put that aside, and we look at just the memory phase and scale that accordingly. So that's qualitative. Now more quantitatively, we evaluate a 4-core one channel system, large number of workloads, about 300 multi-program workloads, spec CPU 2006. So here are here is actual slowdown over time, and here are slowdown estimates from STFM, a similar mechanism as FST, and here are slowdown estimates from our model. I mean, it turns out that they are pretty accurate, and the reason I really think is because we prioritize an application, give it highest priority before estimating its alone request service rate, and I think that takes away a large part of the interference. And this insight was not present in previous works. And to give you some average numbers, the average error of MICE is about 8.8%. Average error of STFM FST is about 35.4%. Okay. So now we have slowdown estimates. We have relatively accurate slowdown estimates. What do we do with them? So you can do things like FST was suggesting, but then here I present a different application which is becoming, so in some sense the reason I'm talking about this application today and FST did not, then is perhaps because it's become more of a problem today, where there is a need to provide performance guarantees to different applications. So the goal is to ensure that the applications for whom quality of service matters, or for whom more concretely slowdown matters, they ensure that they meet a prescribed slowdown bound, while maximizing performance for the other applications in the workload, right? And the basic idea is to allocate just enough bandwidth, the quality of service critical application, and use the remaining bandwidth for the other application's performance. So here is a more concrete mechanism, estimate slowdown, and at the end of an interval, if slowdown is greater than a bound, meaning it's not meeting a bound, then give that application more bandwidth, meaning allocate more bandwidth. If it's meeting a bound, decrease its bandwidth allocation. And here comes the interesting part of MICE again, is when the slowdown bound is not met, communicate this information to the operating system, right? So it's possible that despite giving an application highest priority 100% of time, its slowdown bound might not be met. And the reason is, as I illustrated a few slides back, other applications requests could come in and could take over memory bandwidth even when an application is highest priority, right? So which is why when the bound is not met, notify the operating system and let it take charge. So the OS has a more global view of the system, right? It knows which are all the nodes and what is the loading on different nodes, slowdown estimates from all the nodes, can use all of that information and perhaps use it in a smarter way to migrate or to do admission control. So I'm skipping. So let me just talk about a sample workload. I'll maybe skip some other results. But here is one workload, 4-core workload, if you see. There are 4 applications in the workload, and the y-axis is slowdown. Okay? So this mechanism here is the baseline that we compare to. And I'll talk about what that is, right? Let's say you had no notion of slowdowns, okay? If you had no notion of slowdowns, what is the best thing you could do? You could always prioritize the quality of service critical application, right? Assuming we had just one quality of service critical application, you always prioritize it. So that's what this mechanism does. And it turns out that Leslie is the application whose quality of service we care about in this case. It's a spec CPU 2006 application. So that's the application you care about, and always prioritizing it gets its slowdown to that point. And the other thing is, you can't give any bounds to this mechanism because it's a best effort mechanism. You can't tell it, let's meet a slowdown of 1, 2, 3, and so on. So here is our mechanism, MICE-QoS, for a range of bounds. So don't focus on the exact numbers themselves. You just need to know that as the number grows, the bound becomes tighter. Okay? So as you can see, let's look at this Leslie alone first. So when the bound is loose, 1, 3, and so on, the slowdown was higher. But the bound became tight, the quality of service critical application slowdown decreases and eventually converges to the always prioritized mechanism. So if you have a very tight bound, if you insist that a very tight bound we met, the best that can be done is to always prioritize the application, right? So mice falls back on that. Mice eventually does that when a bound is very tight. But if the bound is relatively loose, it helps. It has higher slowdown for this application, but it has lower slowdown for the other applications in the mix. Does that make sense? Or anything else needs to be explained here? So basically, like I said, the goal to put this back together with the goal is to achieve the bound for the quality of service critical application while improving performance for the other applications in the workload, reducing the slowdown as much as possible. Right. So now to give you some average numbers, the bound can be met or not met, right? It's possible because we have an error of about 8.8%. So that means the bound could be met or not met, and it could be predicted right or wrong. So there are really two numbers that I want to draw your attention to. First is 78.8%, which is the fraction of time that the bound is met and is also predicted right. So that's the good number. And then the bad number is this part, where the bound is not met and you think it's met, meaning it's predicted wrong, right? So that's really a fall. I mean, you really don't want that happening. Say you're running your job on a cluster and they think that the bound is met, but the bound is not really met. But that's a bad case, and that happens only 2.2% of the time. So it's a relatively low number, and minimizing that number would be keeping it as low would be a good idea. Next, I'll present the performance of the So far, this showed the average quality of service enforcement effectiveness of mice. Next, let's look at how it improves the performance of the other applications in the workload, right? So here is average slowdown. That's the metric I present. And these are average bars averaged across a large number of workloads, okay? So this x-axis here shows the number of memory intensive benchmarks in a workload. So of the other three applications in a workload, zero of them could be memory intensive, one of them could be, two of them could be, three of them could be. I'm not showing zero here because it's the uninteresting case. There are no memory intensive benchmarks, there's hardly any, you know, change, right? But I'm showing the interesting case where there's one, two, and three memory intensive benchmarks. So first of all, as the intensity grows, the average slowdown grows, which is something you would expect. Next, on average, when the slowdown bound is loose, meaning when this number is low, the average slowdown is lower. Because when the bound is loose, you don't need to give much bandwidth to the quality of service critical application, which we don't show here. So these applications that are not quality of service critical, they benefit when the bound for the quality of service critical application is loose. And second, let's just pick a point. Mice QoS3 has lower average slowdown, about 10% lower average slowdown than always prioritize, just as a comparison point. So if you think about it, we're really positioning mice as an approach for, if you really want to say that the slowdown has to be one, right? That's perhaps not what we're designing for. But we're really designing for the case where if you say the slowdown can be 2x, 3x, and so on, we can ensure that the quality of service critical application meets that slowdown of 3x, 2x, or whatever, but also improve performance for the other applications, which would not be possible without accurate slowdown estimates. So that's really our contribution, I think. So I will skip this case study in the interest of time, and I'll summarize. So before I summarize, I guess, this is, in some sense, in this work, we're really presenting a hardware substrate, right? We've not really explored its full potential in terms of what this information can enable you to do. So like I said at some point, if you expose this information to the operating system, it can enable admission control policies, which means when you're trying to put applications on a machine, you look at the slowdowns of the application that are already running on it. If the slowdowns are very high, then you perhaps don't want to put any new application on it. That's what I mean by admission control. Next is migration. Say slowdowns are very high and they are intolerable, right? So let's migrate some of the applications running on this machine and put them on a different machine. Billing policies like I talked about earlier. And the other direction is to improve the model itself. So we really want to build a comprehensive model, like in some sense similar to what FST does, but using R principles, which are simpler and more accurate, you know, modeling. So build a more comprehensive model and provide performance predictability with other shared resources as well. And possibly extend this to heterogeneous systems with, you know, CPUs, GPUs, accelerators, and other kinds of cores. So to summarize, the problem we tackled is memory interference slows down different applications to different degrees. And there's a need to provide predictable performance in the presence of memory interference. The solution is a new slowdown estimation model. Average error is about 8.8%, pretty accurate. And our model enables better quality of service enforcement policies. So here is one application of our model, providing soft cures guarantees. There are other possible mechanisms that exist. So this paper is not really up because it got accepted only recently. It was under submission till recently. So I guess I don't know if it's going to be put up. At some point when it's ready, I guess you guys can read it if you're interested. So memory management is an interesting topic. So there's interference reduction, which we looked at so far. Distributed memory controller management, you have multiple memory controllers, how do you manage them? How do you coordinate memory management with interconnection caches? So FSD tries to do it for caches, but how about interconnects as well? And when there are new technologies, right, there's die stacking, 3D, where you try and put this one layer of your CPUs, and on another top layer you can put your DRAM. So DRAM is no more off chip. It's sitting on the same package, right? So that way you don't have to, it takes shorter amount of time to access DRAM. So what does that enable for you? And that DRAM is going to be limited in the sense that it can't be huge. So how do you best use that DRAM cache? Think of it as a cache. How do you best use it as a cache? And when you have non-volatile memory, PCM, phase change memory, which Han has been working on for quite a bit, how do you manage data between DRAM and non-volatile memory? So these are all, I think, interesting areas. So it's a rich topic where there's definitely more scope for doing different things. With that, I guess I'll call it a day. Thanks. Well, any questions? I mean, I forgot to ask that because you guys have not asked me anything so far, but. Okay, cool.